four Columbia University thesis films. So these are four films that were made in this last year in the film program, and they all screened at the Columbia University Film Festival, which I'll tell you a little bit more about right before the screening. So, with that bit of introduction, I'd like to introduce the first faculty member who's going to take the podium up here today, and that is Hilary Brock. So, Hilary teaches directing here at Columbia Film, and she's also the current chair of the film program. She currently has a film playing at a number of festivals called South Mountain. The film is screened at South by Southwest, at Woodstock Film Festival, at AM Cinema Fest, and elsewhere. I looked it up this morning, and it's also currently sitting pretty at 100% on Rotten Tomatoes.
We want to connect to each other, we want to rebuild the world, in a more interesting way. However, the forces that drive economics often forces filmmakers into working in isolation. So whether you come here or not, I hope you connect with some interesting filmmakers and you carry that spirit forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Hillary. Our next speaker will begin the portion of the presentation where we discuss the specific concentrations. So we will start with the directing concentration. Our first speaker on that front is Eric Mendelson, who is one of our longtime directing instructors. Eric has had multiple films screened at the Cannes Film Festival. Recently, he co-wrote and co-produced the feature Love After Love, starring Andy McDowell and Chris McDowell. Please help me where. Help me welcome Eric Mendelson.
Hey, everybody. So I was desperately trying to think about what you need to hear, you know, what it is you're really thinking about right now. So I want to use words that hopefully get to the center of something, because maybe that's a better way of communicating what it's like at Columbia Film. And what I mean by that is getting to the center of something. And when I was younger, you'd get these books about filmmaking. And that was really all you had, was there was this film culture that you guys know about. The film schools were around, but you've got these books. And all they told you about directing was anecdotes. You know, some director got mad at some actor and did this funny thing to get a performance. And I was always thinking, where did they put the camera and why? And some of they would say, this film almost didn't get made. But then something occurred over a weekend. And I thought, when I get there, that will happen. I need to know other information. There must be something that's smaller, a smaller component of why you do what you do. As a director, there's got to be something that's more, I don't know, and closer to the art form than these little stories that sound so much fun, you know? And so that goes a lot towards how directing is handled at Columbia. There's a lot of places, if you're lucky to get into multiple places, you'll have choices from places that have big, shiny glass and steel buildings, and they'll say, look at our Dolly track, and you'll sort of get that feeling you get when you read those books. I don't know what and why you'd use a Dolly track, but they have it there, and it's amazing. What we teach here at Columbia comes from a group of people who understand that you need to understand filmmaking and story before you understand where to put the camera. Because when you come to a set, as a director, that's what people ask you. What are we shooting today? Why? What did you decide? And if you, at this point in your life, you might have shot some stuff, and you know that the scariest thing in the world is sitting alone in your room, and you think to yourself, start with a wide shot. No, let's start with just the hand. We'll pull, no, the flower pot, come around. And it all just seems to be arbitrary. So Columbia, in a sense, in directing, is demystification. We start with the principles of visual storytelling. We start with basics, and we build and build. And every project you do here at Columbia is first created to test your ability to actually use the medium of film. And you're thinking now, he's using those words in the books again. Use the medium of film. Let me explain. When the internet got huge and everyone had a camera in their phone, I started to worry, like, oh, maybe what I do and love is out of fashion now, because everyone can do it. Well, maybe you've experienced this like I have. Now that everyone has an ability to make a movie, and everyone posts movies constantly, daily, there's a difference, and you're aware of it. And if you've ever failed directing a movie, you know there's a difference between just shooting what people say and do and getting an audience to care for an amount of time. And you know when you failed. So the thing that we do at Columbia has nothing to do with the bright, shiny trinkets of filmmaking. Those all come. They all come at the end in the later projects you do. We teach in the beginning the thing that is missing from everything that everyone posts, everything my aunt decides is a film when she films her kids in the backyard and says, I made a film, Eric. That there is a language that you know when you're in the presence of it. You know when you don't know it. You know when you're not employing it. And we want to teach you this excessively more difficult and more complex set of assignments and films. I keep calling them assignments because they're artwork. We teach you to make more complex language of your own, because we never want to tell anyone what a film is. We give you the principles that people have been using for centuries in storytelling. You'll come and be the novel, interesting perspective on that. Let me just say anything else I wanted to say. And here's the other thing that, look, we'd be crazy, and I'm also the chair of the admissions committee for many years now, we'd be crazy if we didn't understand that this is an immense, expensive, terrifying choice. We understand that as people, not as administrators, as human beings who have children who are investing in something. We put people in the field. So there's always this question, why do you choose a film school when it costs so much money and it's such a time-consuming, energy-consuming, over and over and over again, and not for 1 year or 2 years? We put a variety of types of new voices for decades, and it's pleasurable. And I'll talk more about that, but I think, does that cover things for now? Good. Okay, I'll talk more as the chair of admissions in a minute, and then we'll talk for a long time after.
Thank you so much, Eric. So next, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the screenwriting concentration here at Columbia Film. To do that, I'm going to invite Professor Jamal Joseph up to the podium. Jamal is a writer, poet, activist, and Oscar nominee. He recently directed and co-wrote the feature chapter and verse, A Harlot's Story. Please help me welcome Jamal Joseph.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Storytellers wanted, collaborators needed, dreamers, doors wide open. In screenwriting, we start with the page because the script that you create in screenwriting is a blueprint for so many other things. It is something that directors will use, or that you will use as a director, that producers have to help you figure out how to make, that other people will come on, board to help you. Most often, you know, classmates, and that would be a lot of the people who are in this room. But we start from the point of, in Screenwriting 1, to talk about the fundamentals of screenwriting. We have a mix of people, because of the way that we look at admissions, who come from various backgrounds. Some have had a lot of film experience, some come from theater, some come from the business world, the dance world. Some are working folks that might be people who have gone to law school but decided, I'm a storyteller. And that's why we say storytellers are needed. So it is an environment where people collaborate and work hard, but it's not a competition. It's an environment where ideas are welcome and nourished, but there's not a ranking system. The competition is not with each other, and it's not even hopefully a competition with yourselves. It's a safe space that we hope becomes a great space. Brave enough to try new ideas, brave enough to be willing to fail, because if you're going to come and write the same thing over and over again, then that's a waste of your time and your money. But but if you were to come to explore, to exercise and flex those creative muscles, then this might be the right environment for you. So we build on that and start by writing short scripts. You start by writing things that you can direct and that classmates can collaborate with on. And then the journey quickly goes from features in one semester to a feature over the course of two semesters. Along the way, in the same way that Eric was talking about the craft of directing, we will give you craft and tools for screenwriting. But we emphasize that they should be considered to be tools and not rules. Because the idea of coming to Columbia is not to confine you, to make you afraid to write, afraid to direct, afraid to try anything new, to crush or contain your spirit, but to give you what you need so that you can blossom. So that a few years from now, people are seeing your work, that you're making your work, that they're celebrating something that you saw that other people didn't saw, that you brought to the page and to the screen. That's the atmosphere. The workshops are small, collaborations are great, it's honest. So when I say safe space, it's not that everything you write is going to be good and precious, but that's why you come to an environment where you realize that you're here to grow together. So I think that's what we'll say about screenwriting for now. We'll hear a little bit more about TV writing in a second, and then we'll be around to answer more individual questions.
Thank you, Jamal. So as Jamal alluded to, we also have a sub-concentration within the screenwriting concentration for TV writing specifically. You're going to hear about that sub-concentration now from Professor David Glass. David is a novelist and screenwriter whose credits include Kiss the Girls, starring Morgan Freeman, and Walking Tall, starring Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Please help me welcome David Glass.
TV concentration is really interesting, these sort of two prongs. On the one hand, we embrace a wonderful tradition at Columbia that really focuses on storytelling. And not just on storytelling, but on really you bringing us your stories. We're not going to give you the stories. And our job is to help you find your voice, to help you tell those stories in the best possible way, which makes it a joy as a writer to teach at this school. And maybe the best way I can explain that part of it to you is just by talking for a second about the class that I'm teaching now, which is Intro to Pilot Writing. It's sort of the basic foundational class of the TV writing concentration. The class I'm teaching now has 12 students. Two of them are playwrights from the theater program, because the TV writing concentration lives between the theater program and the film program. And it's really wonderful to have that cross-pollination. They're great at dialogue. They know three-act structure. So it's really nice to have them in the class. I have five international students from international backgrounds in my class of 12 right now. One of the joys of teaching in this program is how diverse it is. So they come in, and a lot of them had never written a TV pilot script before. Some of them knew very little about American TV. And my job as a teacher in this class is that at the end of the class, all 12 of them are holding a pilot script that they've written, that actually, hopefully, is a pilot script that they could show professionally. And the first part of that class, and the part that I'll talk just for a second about now, is that they have to come up with ideas for shows. And that's really the most critical part, because if you don't come up with a good idea for a show, what's going to come out is not going to be good. And because of this storytelling tradition at Columbia, I'm not interested in them trying to come up, look at what's hot on TV right now, and try to handicap it, and come up with the most commercial idea. But we talk endlessly about trying to find out what's important to them, what the students' stories are. Because if they care about it, if they're passionate about it, it's going to make a really good TV pilot. So that's sort of on helping writers find their stories and figure out the best ways to tell them. But on the other hand, we are very aware, I run this program with someone named Blair Singer, and Blair and I are very aware that a lot of the students that come through our program, as Eric mentioned, are making a significant financial commitment to come here. And to be frank, are going to graduate in debt. And I graduated from Plum School and spent 5 years driving around Los Angeles in a car without air conditioning. And one of the windows didn't roll down. So I know this on a very personal level. And we're also aware, because of what's happening right now out in Los Angeles in the world of entertainment, a lot of our students, whether they're TV concentrates or whatever they are, their first job is very likely to be in the world of TV. So we want to make sure, running the concentration, that on the one hand, we provide students, we help them find their voice and come up with stories they care about. But on the other hand, we want to make sure when you come through the TV program, you get a very real-world picture of what's happening out there today in TV, and that we do everything we possibly can to help you transition to the industry and have all the tools necessary to get that first job in the industry. And that's equally important to us. It's tremendously important. And one way we do that is by bringing in teachers who are working in TV right now in different areas of TV. And there's a parade of them who come in. And they're all different. They work in different areas of TV, but they answer very real-world questions. How do I get my manager? What should I be writing? And I'll just mention three of them that we have teaching right now. Teaching Intro to Pilot, along with me, is a gentleman named Matt Williams, who teaches Introduction to Comedy Pilot. And Matt created the show Roseanne, and is just a legend in the world of TV, and he's teaching Intro to Pilot. We had a Michael Waythorn just finish a master class. Michael taught a master class in comedy writing, and he created King of Queens. And finally, in a week or two, we're bringing in someone for the first time named Carter Bays, who will be teaching a class in running a comic writing room. And Carter created How I Met Your Mother. So we try to bring these people in who are actually working in the industry, who created shows. They're all different. But the more you come to this program and are exposed to them, the more you'll be prepared to go out there and actually get a job, which we'll talk about more when we sit down together. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, David. So the third and final concentration within Columbia Film is the Creative Producing Concentration. So Professor Ira Deutschman is here to discuss creative producing. Ira has worked in the independent film sphere for decades. His producing credits include the film 54 and All I Want to Do. We recently held a retrospective of his films here at Ledbetter Center for the Arts, its screening room, just last year. So please help me welcome Ira Wood.
So you were all saying to yourself, okay, here's the producing guy, so it's not going to be as heartfelt or as entertaining. But I'm going to let you know a little secret, which is I'm actually the most entertaining person on the faculty. Just a quick show of hands, how many people in here think you're interested potentially in the creative producing program? All right, I want you to look at each other just because when we go to the snacks, maybe you can find each other and hang out and talk for a bit. What is a producer? It's actually one of the big mysteries of the film business. And that's partially because there are so many different types of producers. The fact is that there are two historical definitions of what a producer does, one of which was formed in Hollywood, which is that producers are management, basically taking care of what the studio's needs are and essentially holding the hammer to make sure that people do what they need to be doing to create the product that the studios want them to create. And the other one really comes from Europe, which is based on the auteur theory, where producer's job is to make sure that the director and the rest of the creative team had everything they needed in order to make the film everything it could be. We actually subscribe to a third model at Columbia that is probably an accident of geography having to do with the fact that we're in New York. And grew up, this department grew up simultaneously with the American independent film movement, which was pretty much based in New York. And by our definition, in the best case scenario, the producers and directors are full partners on trying to get everything that is needed to make a project as good as it possibly can be, and that two sides of the same brain, with the goal of the best possible film, best possible TV show, whatever it is. Now, there's also a little bit of confusion about calling our program the creative producing program, because I think that people lock on to this word creative, and in reality, it's redundant, because every aspect of producing is creative. My friend Whit Stillman, who I work with on the film Metropolitan, which some of you may be aware of, he once was quoted as saying that the budget is the aesthetic, which is to say that limitations are the seeds of creativity. The best independent films have always been films that have been made because of their limitations into something that makes them truly original. When you have unlimited resources, it's too easy to be lazy, creatively and otherwise. And we believe that wholeheartedly. The Producer Guild has a list of the responsibilities of the producer that they publish because they're the ones who arbitrate who gets what credits on a film. And if you look at that list, it's incredibly intimidating because it's pages and pages and pages of stuff. And part of the problem is that they're not saying out loud what we know to be true, which is that there's nobody who's ever lived who's capable of doing all of those things. So that list might be intimidating, but ultimately you need to surround yourself with other people, otherwise things don't get done. So it's all about collaboration. So, okay, our program. The Creative Producing Program at Columbia allows students to find their own strengths and interests as a producer. In other words, with all of those responsibilities that we just talked about that the PGA lays out, the producers in this program are able to figure out which ones they're most suitable for and then surround themselves with people who can fill in the blanks. The proof that it works is in the achievements of our alums who are working at the major studios, they're working on low-budget indie films, they're working on foreign co-productions, they're working in televisions in capacities as wide-ranging as development executives at talent agencies, line producing, casting, location managing, post-production, and some have found their way into writers' rooms on various TV series. The skills that are learned in the program are relevant to just about every capacity of the film and entertainment business. And solid producers, especially if they're trained in the American way of doing business, are in great demand all over the world. At Columbia, we believe that producers, directors, and writers need to know all the disciplines in order to be effective. We also believe that producers, writers, and directors need to be very focused and specific in the instruction that they get to do the best in their varied roles. So this leads me to a really important point about our program, which is that in the first year of the program, all of the concentrations take all the same classes. You all get exposed to writing, directing, directing actors, the experience of writing an 8 to 12, directing an 8 to 12 minute film, big project that happens at the culmination of the first year. So in the first year, the integrated year as we call it, the producers spend a lot of time in non-producing classes. This is the time in which we encourage them to get to know the directors and the writers in the program and to start forging collaborations that will follow them through the program. As far as I know, this is the only producing program anywhere that puts an emphasis on producers' understanding and experiencing all aspects of filmmaking as an essential background to being the best producers they can be. But then in the second year, you are completely focused on producing. And I'm just going to go through some of the areas we cover so that you know how wide-ranging it is, but it starts with project development, which includes copyright law, deal-making, understanding the marketplace, working within the major studio structure or independently. Financing. We exist in New York halfway between Hollywood and Europe, which I think of as an example, as a real advantage, because it means that we're in a good time zone to be able to call you a direction. But it also means that we understand and we teach different types of financing, including equity investment, corporate structures, territorial pre-sales, international co-productions, crowdfunding, grant writing, fiscal sponsorship, etc. Script analysis, writing coverage, identifying good stories, doing script notes. On the line producing side, planning, budgeting, scheduling, accounting, troubleshooting, dealing with the unions and liability issues. Post-production supervision, which, by the way, is in very, very high demand. There are so many job openings in that area that I wish we had separate concentration. Marketing and distribution, talking about changes in the marketplace, theatrical, television, streaming services, and other new platforms as they develop. And then finally, leadership and management skills. When you're a producer, you spend a lot of time dealing with diffusing conflict and finding responsible collaborators that one can delegate to. Just remember that no producer can do it all. And then there are some electives that I just want to throw out there quickly. Documentary producing. We believe that that documentaries are storytelling in the same way that fiction films are storytelling, and that the fundamentals are actually the same, but the production process is different. And that's the basis of that particular course. Digital storytelling, we created this thing called the Digital Storytelling Lab at Columbia, which has been experimenting with new forms of storytelling. We have a three-course sequence that gets into transmedia, gaming, artificial intelligence, and immersive storytelling. Entertainment law, the basics that are needed by any producer to be effective. And then there are also some limited writing courses that are potentially available as electives for those of you who want to continue practicing and developing stories. And these are geared specifically to the needs of students in the producing program and emphasize identification of good material and strategizing about the best medium in which to tell that particular story. There's also courses in the business school, the theater department, and other Columbia departments that are potentially open and available. And that's true, by the way, for the writing directing program as well. Just real quickly, the thesis for a producer is a short film that you're the sole producer on. We also require that you work on at least two other films in which you have a responsible role. There's a required internship, and I might add that we work with the students to try to identify internships that expose them to the areas of the business that fill in gaps in their knowledge, and that you can do the internships anywhere. It doesn't have to be in New York. It could be New York, LA, Austin, London, Paris, Shanghai. You come out of the program with a portfolio of films that you've produced, and also, if you play your cards right, a fully developed feature script and business plan that's developed with fellow students over the second year. So you can get out, potentially you can get your first feature done in collaboration with a writer or writer-director in the program. So finally, I just want to point out, the Creative Producing Program is a separate but parallel program within the film division. We share the same DNA with the writer-directing program in that we stress story. We keep hearing that over and over and over again, but story as it relates to producing. Collaboration, which is one of the reasons we have this foundational combined first year, and diversity. Students from all cultures and from all over the world. One of the biggest pleasures is seeing collaborations between students from vastly different worlds, making movies together, sometimes shot in a place that neither of them has ever worked before. We have a separate admissions process from the writer-directors because we're looking to students, for students, who want to produce. Sometimes this means people who have already had some kind of experience in the film industry but want to learn more about producing in order to take more control of their careers or branch out in different directions. Some of these folks have been actors, documentary filmmakers who want to move over into fiction, people with crewing experience who are ready to step up to more responsibility and more creativity. Others choose producing because they've tried different roles and realized that producing better fits their individual skills, temperament, or their appetite to be prolific. So that's a very quick summary of the program. Like everybody else, I'll be available to answer questions and to talk afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ira. So now that you all have a general overview of the three concentrations of the program, we'd like to go over how you can go about applying. To help guide you through this process, I'd like to invite back up to the podium Eric Mendelson, along with Julie Dobrow, the Dean of Admissions and Financial Aid here at Columbia's School of the Arts.
There, welcome. Thank you guys so much for coming this afternoon. Particularly because you had to navigate that kind of construction site right in front of this building. So normally, just so you know, this building actually looks right out onto 125th Street, and it's kind of an opening to Columbia's new campus in the Manhattanville neighborhood. The construction that you see is part of the Year of Water, which is something that an initiative that Columbia has taken on across the university to highlight the issues that we're having with climate change and availability of clean water. So as part of that, the School of the Arts is mounting a huge installation this Tuesday and Thursday called Water Leak by the artist Dan Rosengard. It's open to the public, so if you're interested in coming back, it seems like it's going to be truly extraordinary. It's basically an outdoor exhibit that's going to happen between Tuesday and Thursday. I think it's from 7:30 to 11 p.m. Just so you actually do have to RSVP. Tickets are free, but we need to know how many people are coming in terms of crowd control and all that, but if you're interested, please look it up. It's on our website. Again, I'm Julie Dobrow. I'm the Dean of Admissions and Financial Aid at Columbia. I'm also an alum of the theater program in the theater management and producing concentration, so I've been around here a very long time, and I feel like Columbia is the second home to me. It's a wonderful university. And it's really important to note that while the film program obviously is so full and rich in and of itself, it's part of an overall School of the Arts. There's a theater program, a visual arts program, a writing program, and an interdisciplinary program in sound arts. So there's so much creative collaboration beyond just the film program, and we encourage that as much as possible for events and classes that you guys can cross-register. We want you to get to know the other schools, the other students in the School of the Arts as well. So that's great. Hopefully when you came in, you got to meet some of my colleagues, Kenny and Nicolette and Daima, and myself. We are the four people that make up the Admissions and Financial Aid Office. If you decide to apply, you will be corresponding with any one of us or all of us. We are a very small office, so please do not hesitate in reaching out to any of us personally. We are here to help you and help navigate through this admissions process over the next couple of months. The most important things for you to know are in the paperwork that you have, so you don't have to write it down. But the deadline for the MFA program is December 3rd. That is a hard deadline, unless there's some kind of major crisis, in which case you must certainly let us know about it. I guess if you're very ill or something like that. But apart from that, we really do stick very tight to the deadline because we're reviewing a lot of applications to give the faculty time to review them all and give them all the attention they need. The other deadline that's very important is when our financial aid applications are due. That's the other part of my job. We do have financial aid at the school. We have scholarships that we give out to students that are both need and merit-based, so we kind of put together an algorithm based on how the film faculty reviews your application. That's the merit component. The need component, we get two different applications that we ask you to submit to us. So if you are a U.S. citizen or a permanent resident, it's the FAFSA. You probably know that from undergraduate if you apply for loans through that. So we would ask you to submit a FAFSA application. If you're an international student, we have our own School of the Arts financial aid application, and we ask you to submit that one. So U.S. citizens and permanent residents, we ask for two applications. International students, just the School of the Arts need-based application. And that's how we determine the need portion of your potential contribution. I always tell people, if you think that you need financial aid, please, please, please apply. It is not at all taken into consideration in the application and admissions process. In fact, the financial aid application is not due until February 4th, which is a full 2 months after the rest of your materials are. By that point, the faculty will have reviewed your application. They are completely unrelated. So I always hear students that say, well, I really need aid, but I was afraid that it would make it less likely that I would get in. It will not make it less likely. Please make sure you submit those applications if you think that you need some financial support. Let's see what else. One other thing that I try to stress this early on in the process Columbia's a very expensive school, as David alluded to, and many students do actually have to take out some kind of loans or some kind of financial backing through other sources. Start looking now. It is actually not too early for you to start investigating scholarships, you know, from outside institutions that may be able to fund your education. Many times it's too late once you've gotten the NBA acceptance. You may not hear from us until March, and then you're trying to raise enough money to be able to come here in September, and it can be really tricky. So, you know, take this time now as you're applying, assuming you may be applying to other programs as well, take this time now to do the research and see what else is out there that can potentially help support you when you are in film school. That's really it. We are here, me and my staff will be here all afternoon. We've got our cards downstairs. Please, as I said, don't hesitate to reach out. We are here to answer your questions and hopefully make this process a little bit less daunting. So best of luck.
About to start to answer your questions in the Q&A. But before we do, because we talked about the separate components, the separate concentrations within the film program, I think one thing that generally comes up in questions from you that I want to get out of the way now is the ways in which we differ from other programs as a whole. The ways in which Columbia Film, including writing, screenwriting, TV writing, directing, and producing, differ in a holistic way. So I want to go into that before we answer questions. First of all, we are the only school that I know of that has the first year where everyone does everything. Everyone who applies to the program is going to be taking the same classes. You don't get to choose. Directors are going to be learning producing. Producers are going to be learning directing and screenwriting. Everyone falls on each other for help. Everybody finds out what their weaknesses are, what their strengths are. It's very leveling in a great way. It's very similar to what a crew is like. A bunch of people who need to know stuff from each other. One thing that is, if you haven't been listening, now is the time, just listen. In screenwriting and directing, there is a huge difference between our program and the other programs that you can apply. Aside from the fact that we should say out loud, you're in, Columbia is one of the best programs, one of four, let's say, in the whole world. So that sounds like patting ourselves on the back. It's actually a ton of work, and we're proud to be able to continue to say that for decades because of who our students are, and hopefully because of who we are as well. But in screenwriting and directing, there is no other program where you can take, let's say it this way, we believe in the screenwriter-director, that model, that person. You don't have to be that person. We have people who come here and say, I'm just a television writer, I'm just a screenwriter, I never liked taking the directing classes. A large percentage of people who come to Columbia do feel like they are a writer-director, and we're the only program that teaches the complete course list, the complete curriculum, as if you just went to study at a film school as a screenwriter, you can also study the complete curriculum of directing. And same thing for directors. You come here and think, yeah, I'm pretty much a director. We also say you can take the entire curriculum, basically, of screenwriting or TV, and there are minor, you know, changes and minor things that you have to apply for, but you can, it's like two MFAs is what I'm trying to say. Now, if you don't want it, that's up to you, you understand that. But other programs, writing is on one floor, and directing is some in another building. We don't believe that, you learn everything. So that's a big difference. And it isn't just like lip service. There's Elise Sluder, whose film you're going to watch today. Elise, I think I would pretty confident say I know every edit in your film. Yes, side by side for weeks on end. Her concentration is not directing. I know your 8 to 12 very well. You are a producer with directing talent. Where's Jackie? Jackie is taking my class right now. Jackie's a producer. She's taking a class that looks at a very, very intense, sophisticated look at the component parts of what directing is. And she's got the best comments in the class, I have to say. So that's a way in which we differ from other schools. Other schools are, and Barbara. Barbara is a producer here as well. These are a group of people who I trust to talk about filmmaking in a holistic way. That defines Columbia. There are other places where it's all separate and you're taught some little skill. Has that ever been your experience, by the way, as a director, that you didn't do any producing, that you didn't have to fix the writing or be the writer or then be the producer? Of course, more now so than ever. That is Columbia film. It'd be a lot easier if I just pretended that the only thing you're going meet in your career was pure directing. People were going to sweep you onto the set to do pure directing. It doesn't happen. You're a producer, you're a director, you're a screenwriter. Always. If you're a producer, you're all three of those. A screenwriter, you're all three of those. That's what we do at Columbia. The other thing to say about Columbia, and it's an art school still. You might be thinking to yourself, like, well, I don't know. Frozen 2 is coming out. Why is that art? Or you might say to yourself, like, how is it that all these animated films come out of here, but we don't teach animation? Or why is one of the great documentary producers came out of our program, but we don't really always, we're not a documentary school. We teach the building blocks of these things, and it's dicey. If you watch that video that they have up there, you hear me saying that over and over again. It's because we live it. We teach you building blocks in more and more sophisticated ways to do whatever you want to do. For my students, just out of school, I mean, they just graduated, and they were the writers on Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon. I don't know, it's something my godson is playing. Why? They're not gaming. We didn't teach gaming here. But I got them those jobs simply through Columbia name, and they understood screenwriting. And that's storytelling, and that's what they wanted when they hired these game developers. We're an art school because we're teaching fundamentals that can do anything and go anywhere. It'd be easy, come on. It'd be very easy if we looked at what was on the cover of, you know, the Hollywood Reporter, and said, this is very popular. You do that, you'll be safe. It's not safe. It's not easy on us either. Keep learning what is film, what is TV, over and over and over and over again. You guys bring new ideas. We have principles that work. And the other thing was mentioned already, which is, do not start looking for funding once you get in. That's like a dream. That's like, I got in, now that will be the coasting downhill like the Grinch with all the presents, you know? No. Start thinking now. It's a very expensive thing, film school. Not just us, but we are expensive. Start thinking about it now, and now we'll open it up to questions, but I just want to get those things out of the way.
Thank you, Greg. So we have a couple of floating microphones for any of you who have questions for any of the faculty or staff members that you see up here. Just raise your hand and we'll get you a microphone. Oh, right over there.
Hi, yeah. I was curious if directing involved cinematography as well. One other is, does you being a student in Columbia undergrad affect possible mission negatively going into grad school?
The answer to the first question is we teach cinematography here. We don't have a track for cinematography because we couldn't do it well. If you want to be a cinematographer, don't come, really, truly. We have, you know, Chris T just won the Emmy this year for cinematography. He's our alum. He came for writing, directing. We have tons of cinematographers. But they started out as writer-directors to learn about story. We teach cinematography from the point of view of a director or writer or producer. And so we have an amazing cinematography teacher. People are like, crazy to learn from him, but that answered your question?
No, thank you.
Okay, and wait, the second one was what? When we're serving on the bagels? I think it's just a plain old spoon.
I just heard what not necessarily meant.
Oh, yeah, don't worry. Don't worry. The question was, if you went to Columbia undergrad, do we care? Look, it's an elite school, but not elite in the way that's scary. Like, I nearly failed out of high school. It's an elite school for people who are interested and excellent and have potential in storytelling. If you went to Columbia undergrad, you still have to live up to what we and film are looking for. It doesn't help you. We don't say, oh, well, they're shiny bright and have know the campus well. We'll be as critical of you as anybody else. That's the sort of stuff we don't really look at. You know, whether you did well in, you know, trigonometry or poli sci, I don't care. That's not gonna come up.
Awesome, thank you so much.
All right, I see a hand back there.
Hi, this is a question about financial aid. So I'm curious, on average, what percentage of students receive aid, and let's say for the first 2 years, because after that it's a bit different, and what percentage of that aid is the tuition coverage?
Hi. So aid is given out to you guys in various different formats. There's straight scholarships, which are basically awards that we give you that come off the cost of tuition on the top. We also have work positions within the film department called service positions, and that's they're usually $20 or $25 an hour. Those are positions whether you're working for the Digital Media Center, whether you're working as a faculty assistant, helping with the film festival, those types of things. And there's also TA and teaching fellow positions as well. So those are kind of the various ways in which you can get support from Columbia. As an incoming first year, really the only one that would be offered to you would be a scholarship. A large percentage of our students who come and get some kind of scholarship support, I think this past year was around 67%, are getting at least some kind of scholarship support from the university. That percentage increases significantly over the next year because of the service positions. Once they start to kick in, a lot of students, pretty much, I don't want to say every student, but most students who are interested in service positions will get something. Whether again it's something technical, if you have some skills in terms of digital media, then that's certainly helpful. But there's also positions within the School of the Arts, helping my office, helping the alumni office, that type of thing. The TA and teaching fellow positions start applying for them when you are spring semester first year. The teaching fellow positions tend to be for third-year students, which are, the third year is called research arts, so you actually don't have full-time class in your third year. You're working on your thesis, you're taking workshops with the faculty or bringing people in to lead, and the third year you certainly have much more time to take on any of these job positions. Did I answer your question?
Let me address your question. Number one, the 67% for this last year, it was actually 100%, but the 67 represents people who asked for aid and the rest of those people didn't. So we try for 100% that everyone in the class should receive something, but wait a second. The way I put it year in and year out is that there is almost no amount that we can give that does not take away the enormous burden of being in debt. In other words, we can't go into what everyone gets, and every year it changes, truly. It's based on the people applying. This year, 100% writer-directors who asked for it got something. However, there were very few people who thought, this is going to be easy now. This is going to be a totally easy, it's a no-brainer to go to school. The amount of money we're able to give oftentimes still leaves people with a huge adult decision about debt and their future. So I don't want to kid you that 100% got something. 100% got something and it helps.
And the awards are in the range of $10,000, $20,000, $30,000. The tuition this year is $62,000. So there are very, very, very few, very rare full tuition fellowships. Those tend to be for students who are in particular circumstances like we like a student who's a refugee from a foreign country, that type of thing. But I don't want anyone to come in thinking that the tuition is going to be covered because it's extremely rare. So there is going to be a burden on you, a financial burden on you to make up that difference and send expensive programs. So, you know, we have those very hard conversations in the spring, and members of my staff, the financial aid staff, meet the students individually, and we're happy to go over your particular situation and help you, you know, figure out the budgeting and whether or not this is something that, that you can handle.
Thank you. I have one more question, but it's a simpler one. How many of your permanent faculty are women?
I think I can count this on my fingers. Within the MFA, let's say it's me, Maureen, June, Catherine, Betty, Christina, six.
Out of
25.
Six out of
25. Does that include the FMS?
That's FMS, that's including FMS, and you can
oh, right.
Annette and Jane, you know, quite a few of you.
All right, so it would be 8 out of 25, but out of the MFA, I think it's 8 out of 16, 6 out of 15 or 16.
Yes.
Yes.
And we're also enormously proud. Something that I don't know that we consciously talked about in the past, that the women in our program have really like exceeded anyone's estimation of what one program could have produced. It's astounding when you think of Lisa Cholodenko and Kimberly Pierce and Catherine Bigelow and Lisa. Jennifer Lee, this is an incredible group of people, women, who have come from our program, and we're enormously proud of it, and we often think about what we did to, in any way, foster that, and what we can continue to do to foster it.
All right, any other questions? I see a hand up at the front here.
Thank you, my name is Logan. I was wondering if someone could just sort of generally itemize like the list of editing rooms, production spaces, stages, sort of spaces like that. Thank you.
Actually we have a production center that in the next 3 years we expect to have our studio rebuilt. I will be honest, our studio is large as other people's studios. However, we also have New York City, and we're very proud to push students out into this incredible city to shoot, and I think it's one of the strengths of the program. We've invested a whole lot in equipment in the last few years, so that we have you have a lot of choices. Now, the choices increase as you move through those first two core years. You start with basic packages. By the time you hit research arts, you really have a pretty impressive inventory of options to choose from to shoot your research arts films. We have one of the best staffs. I just working in film, they're just some of the best people I've ever met in terms of finessing that fine line between technical and creative. And they are very, very generous with their time and their instruction. I will be completely honest, we do not perhaps compete with other programs in terms of our host facilities. I'm not going to pretend that we do. However, somehow we keep making a whole bunch of incredible films. You'll find students editing in these communal editing rooms very hard. You know, we're looking into changing things, but for this cohort coming in, know that it's about the know-how within the program that really we turn on a number of not only cinematographers but working editors into the field every year because they cut so much and they really get at it.
Yeah. Okay, I see another Amber at that same table over there.
Thank you. My name's Lynn, and I have a question about the
creative producing, specifically the post-supervision. Is there a focus on communicating and learning the language of the effects and animation, and how we can work as producers to understand what goes into the elements of post?
Yeah, I mean, my answer could be a little bit similar to the answer that Hillary just gave, in the sense that we don't have enormous VFX ability on campus, but it is covered in the post-production courses. And we do, every year, there's at least a few thesis projects where there is a VFX effects component, and where they end up, you know, basically figuring it out by consulting with other students who have done it before, and also going out into the field and finding people who can help them out with it. It's not, you know, it tends not to be a huge part of our program, only because of the kind of material that tends to be made. It's just not that effects driven. But we do, as I said, have a few films every year that go into that. As far as the post-production supervision component of it is concerned, it is covered in the post-production classes that we teach. So it's just a question, and some of that is done in the field, where the class actually goes into various facilities around town to try to show how these things are done.
And the last film that I made, the post-production supervisor was a Columbia alum, and then I got three students that were writer directors, by the way, to shadow, and now they're working as post-production supervisors. So it works a lot in the field, but post-production is something that's out. For whatever reason, it's doing very well with Columbia right now.
Yeah, Barbara, why don't you raise your hand? Barbara is a current creative producing student. You might want to talk to her, because she actually latched on to post-production as an area that she's really interested in, and she could probably answer more specific questions about that for you.
All right, I've got a question way in the back.
Hi, I'm Anushka. I have a question about internships, especially you guys talked a little bit about international internships for students, and can the internship process, maybe the last 2 years, the last year when you're doing research arts, how do you balance that with a thesis work and all that?
So, this happened this week, so it's off the top of my head. Internships used to always be for producing students, and many years ago I decided, hey, you know, producers always graduate with such a kind of hireable skill set. I want the writer-directors to get information about internships. So this week, all of the writer-directors were offered internships with the Sundance Institute doing coverage for their the screenwriting lab. And I would say, although that when you speak to some of the students who are here, I would say that most of the time people wait to do internships into the thesis years, which some people still call the research arts years. But I think, and I think that's best. And every week you get a list in a weekly emailed listing of opportunities. You'll get a list of people in Manhattan or around the world that are hiring and looking for interns. We're always doing that. Also personally lending, you know, the faculty are lending their friends, tapping their friends for internship opportunities. And it's really helpful. I mean, one of my thesis students right now works on Saturday Night Live. So he's actually working in doing, and that's something that was, you know, that the school provided, and now he's working doing painting of sets, but he doesn't care because he's there every week, he gets to see the rehearsal. We had another student here before on one of those late night TV shows that shoots here, but it's very common that if you're up for it and you want it, you can do it, and especially during thesis years.
The research arts or thesis years are very flexible, and we're trying as a faculty to launch you. So if you have an opportunity to do an internship that is going to, for example, take you away from New York, we have an internship set up with a company in Los Angeles, a TV company. they take two students in the spring for 2 months. They pay for the travel, a stipend for living, and they give them real-world experience in what it's like developing projects for TV. That doesn't in any way interfere with their going through the research arts years here at Columbia. We want that. We want things like that.
Okay, we have time for just a couple more questions. Man, right there.
Hi, when you make a film, it's either it's part of a class project or a thesis film, what kind of administrative or infrastructure is there from the school in terms of like either festival service or legal protections, copyright, and what is kind of the ownership status of your films produced under
the simple answer is really simple, which is that unlike a lot of other schools, you own your own work. I mean, we don't take any copyright or any piece of it whatsoever. The support that's available to you is everything from, we have a small department of people who deal with things like insurance issues, and the university does have insurance that you're covered under as long as you follow the rules, and there is a deductible and all that kind of stuff. As far as festival help, we have a staff person whose job it is to advise people on upcoming festivals and how to, she tries to get us discounts or freebies in terms of application fees, tries to keep everybody up to date on what's coming up and what they might be eligible for. Was there any other part of that? Or?
If there's some kind of disputes, does Columbia step in at all in terms of like if, I don't know, just kind of any kind of legal back or the
dispute? Well, there's so many different kinds of disputes, I'm not sure. You know, like if it's something coverable by insurance, then yes. If it's a dispute with somebody outside the university, then that gets stickier. If it's, you talk about intellectual property, like if you make a movie based on a copyrighted work that you don't own, we can't help you there.
And also, does Columbia have, I mean, is there any kind of school-sponsored mechanism, either generating funding for the school or for the...
Once you get, we like to keep the projects in the that are in, within the first 2 years of the curriculum, the cap on is spending very low. We never had the problem where if they just had $30,000 more to make their first film, it really would have rocked. You know, we sort of think and successfully think that it's sort of like the scratch paper you have in art school. These are films that we concentrate on the creative abilities and keep the production low. But as you get out of those first 2 years, you start to be submitting your projects for grants of all different kinds that are both internal to the school and outside people. We've got grants where, like, you know, this sort of answers your first question in a weird way. We have grants where outside donors will want to meet you to see if you're going to get it out of a number of people, and that those kind of things really start to put you face to face with the real world. What is your ability to convince someone that your project is great, whether you're a writer, director, or producer? And a variety of those, and every year we raise the amount of money that we are able to give students. Is it cover everyone still? Nope, it's like the real world. There's as many films as we can cover, but there's always people who have to go into other ways of crowdfunding or raising money, just as in the real world.
I was just gonna add that we do have a thing called the Production Advisory Board. It's a process whereby faculty members sit down and go over things like not only your script but also your budget, production plan, and all that stuff. Try to troubleshoot with you to make sure that you're not going to get into a situation that you can't handle. And our attitude in general is that we just want the films to be done for what for the minimum amount that it would take to actually get them done. We're trying to avoid people spending more money than they have to.
Yeah, I would just note that the number of production grants has gone up exponentially in the last few years. We're not at the place where everyone has a big grant, but we're now, I think, at between 50 and 60% of the films are receiving some decent support. And I would also note that a lot of the great thesis films that come out of the program weren't made for as much as you might think they were. And when we invested in all those cameras and lenses and that type of stuff, we're really thinking about trying to bring those costs down. And I did want to note that we expanded the position of our industry and festival outreach staff member that Ira mentioned last year. So there's regular exit strategy seminars being held throughout the year with industry people coming in, talking to all the concentrations, book programs, about the outside world. And she comes from distribution, and so she is very, very connective and has really been doing a lot of one-on-one work with students coming in from the get-go. So we're thinking hard about trying to offer support for individualized paths into wherever you're going to go.
Within art and within film and art especially, I think innovation is something that's like really important, right? And I think a lot of movies that have been highly influential are things that have very specifically sort of thwarted expectations and the norm of filmmaking. What do you guys do to encourage that sort of innovation within film and the arts?
That's a great question, and it's something that we've in fact, today you're going to see a film, and it divides people, so it's interesting. The film called I Remember It Rained, you'll see the film that someone said, can this be done? And I don't know that there's anything specific, although we've now, just this year, funny that you should ask, been talking about ways in which to promote a kind of thinking outside of just film. So one way that we do that, I started a class that's about directing, but it's also about artwork. So it's just, we play music, we play a variety of music, we show artwork throughout the centuries, just so that you're not just looking at films. And I just brought up to my colleagues in a series of meetings that we have another class that we want to create that's about developing ideas. And so it wouldn't necessarily be, it would be more about, I love this photo of this kid from Afghanistan. I don't know what the character is, but can that be with this thing, this another image and a piece of music? So that's how we work normally, is maybe the best answer to your question. I would say it's how we work normally. In other words, you're asking like, hey, being a traditional film school, and I'm like, no, we're not. The way we work normally is, like my thesis student, who Sean Wines, who came to me and he said, hey, I know that you don't do this kind of work, but you think there's a possibility to do a live action thesis film that's like Family Guy. Could that exist? I said, well, let's do it. And that guy is working really successfully in TV right now. So I think that's the norm, is that we are, I broke down here, I didn't get to say it, but like, this place, look, without mentioning names, you know that there are a lot of programs that don't really care about innovation. They are about surface stuff. So we never had to, we want to augment that, but it's about what we've always done. It's like, probably is best answered in that we don't teach gaming, we don't teach animation, we're not teaching so much about documentary, but we're teaching all those things through art, and art is huge.
Yeah, and just, I might add that we just had our first VR thesis, and we don't teach it, well, we sort of teach it in a visual storytelling lab, but you know, it was something that was a form of storytelling that suited itself to the story that the director and producer decided to do together. And one final thing about exposing the students to all sorts of different kind of formats is that we have constantly on campus screenings of movies that are incredibly diverse in terms of the ways in which they, from all over the world. And many times the filmmakers come in and do Q&As afterwards. And, you know, we try to make sure that as many types of filmmaking are represented in terms of the films shown on campus as possible.
So, but inside of that work is what we were talking about, like, what is the story about, what's the character, what's the thing that's going to set it apart, what even is innovative, that is going to make people lean in, you know, you can allow folks to make them lean back because something is innovative, because it's mixed media, because it's shot well, what makes them lean in, and that's why we were reciting examples of, you know, great animated films that have come out of the program, and you know, people who were working, writing scripts for games, but there's something about them that go, oh, you're from Columbia, you're great with stories. So we get from your pitch that you understand how our games work and what we want to do. We want some of that inside of your best ideas. So probably for screenwriting, the way this follows is that those 4 years we're talking about crap, not limiting story ideas, but whatever idea it is, what's inside of that that's making it work as a story, that's making people want to pay attention to the character in the story. And in the thesis years, I know in my thesis class and other thesis class, we are looking at that, you know, mixed media, experimental films, people breaking the boundaries. Now let's take that crap and see, you know, how we can expand, how we can build experiment in it.
Another way of phrasing your question would be, why do so many other programs, focus on surface innovation? Why are they so interested in what is hot at the moment and doing something that's a really obvious, facile thing? The thing that's going to keep you going in filmmaking is the understanding of what it is that compels people to keep watching, whether it's for 3 minutes, whether it's 15 seconds on whatever that new site that everyone loves, Loki or Lokai, that's the one. We look at those things, you don't go out and be innovative because that's the nature of people who apply to a program is, oh, come on, I hate you, you've taught me this for so long, now I'm gonna show you. Good, show us. And you'll have been hopefully taken in all the structural stuff that's going to keep you going and not make you look like that's a flash in the pan, which, by the way, everyone can see through immediately.
All right, that's all the time that we have for questions for now. Just want to let you know that all of the faculty and staff here are going to join you at your various tables for brunch. So if you have remaining questions, feel free to talk to them. And if you see anyone with a sticker, that means that they are a current student. They're also here to answer questions you have. So we have brunch for you at both tables. And so we'll be here for about another 45 minutes or an hour, and then I'll come.